On March 28, 1982, what was beforehand a small, densely forested hill within a hilly landscape in southeastern Mexico unexpectedly exploded, marking the beginning of what would become the nation's deadliest volcanic eruption. A mushroom-shaped cloud soon rose into the atmosphere, and as the clock struck midnight, thousands of people were sleeping through the event in nearby communities. As part of the eruption column collapsed back to the ground, it generated highly voluminous pyroclastic flows which swept across the landscape at speeds exceeding 80 kilometers per hour, incinerating everything in its path. By a short time later, this superheated gas current had traveled up to 10.6 kilometers away from its source, incinerating a total of 150 square kilometers of terrain. This tragically completely destroyed 9 villages, resulting in the deaths of 1,900 people. This eruption of the El Chichon volcano was a little more than twice the size of the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens, and during the 20th century would rank in as that century's 7th largest explosive eruption, ejecting 2.75 cubic kilometers of tephra. Yet, suppose that this fairy eruption instead occurred 30,000 years ago and that for some unknown reason the thick ashfall deposits it left behind were no longer present in the landscape. Scientists would in this situation often turn to ice core records looking for the amount of sulfate present in the year the eruption occurred to determine the size of the relevant eruption. As the amount of sulfate in an ice core indicates the amount of sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere at that time, which is in place there during any major explosive eruption. For example, the 1815 eruption of Mount Tambora, which is the largest explosive volcanic eruption in the last 500 years, produced the largest spike during that time span, far surpassing the less significant spike created by the 1980 eruption of Mount St. Helens. Yet, if we were to have used the same methodology on El Chichon's hypothetical ancient 2.75 cubic kilometer eruption, the amount of sulfate it emplaced in ice cores would incorrectly lead scientists to believe that the eruption, in fact, was 4 times larger than it actually was, suggesting a borderline or very low NVEI-6 rather than VEI-5 eruption. As El Chichon's 1982 eruption was unusually sulfur dioxide rich, far outpacing any eruption of a comparable size. While only being the 7th largest eruption of the century, it produced the 4th largest sulfate spike, even surpassing the amount a 9.52 cubic kilometer explosive eruption produced. So, why was El Chichon's eruption so unusually sulfur dioxide rich, and what can this teach us about the uncertainty of old volcanic data? For the first part of the question, there are two primary causes. The first factor to consider is that, generally speaking, the amount of sulfur dioxide a volcano produces based on its size is inversely proportional to the amount of silicon dioxide which comprises its erupting lava or ash. However, even after taking this into account, the tracheandesite of El Chichon's 1982 eruption is still an outlier. The primary cause of El Chichon's absurdly sulfur dioxide-rich eruption are what its magmas erupted through. El Chichon's magma chamber is believed to exist at between 5 and 11 kilometers depth, which intersects with a more than 500 meter thick layer beginning at around 4.8 kilometers depth. This layer represents Cretaceous Age evaporite deposits which are very rich in the mineral anhydrite. These layers were largely in place between 110 and 66 million years ago, when at the time this very region was the site of a shoreline of the Atlantic Ocean. Here, numerous large depressions in the ground existed which were above the seasonal high tide mark. These so-called sabcas were unusually dry but on occasion flooded with seawater due to storm surges. The seawater contained the ions of sulfate and calcium, which precipitated to form calcium sulfate, aka anhydrite, once the water eventually evaporated. This process then repeated over and over again for tens of millions of years. Thus, El Chichon's magma chamber not only incorporated large amounts of anhydrite into its composition, but also the same process occurred as its magma advanced upwards before its climactic eruption, with the sulfate eventually largely becoming sulfur dioxide. As a result, when looking at ice core records of large eruptions, you need to take into account the amount of sulfate minerals in the rock units above a magma chamber, in addition to the silica content in a volcano's eruptive products. As a final note, I would like to thank this channel's patrons on Patreon and channel members on YouTube.